Hello, and welcome to KDAB News, the monthly update for professionals working with Qt, C++, and 3D technologies. I'm Robert Brock, and in this edition we have an update and new initiative from KDE, interview with Kai-Uwe Brulig, Qt widgets and more interview with Jesper Petersen, Qt 6.2 alpha released, Qt for MCUs 1.9 released, tool of the month, announcements, and resources. So here with me today to go over some of the updates and upcoming technology is Kai-Uwe from KDE. Hello, Kai-Uwe.
Hi, Robert.
So KDE Academy has just ended. How was the event this year?
Yeah, it's been great. I mean, of course, we had to do it online because of the pandemic, which was still going on. So we hoped that this year we could actually do it in person, but that didn't happen. But yeah, it was a great event.
That's good to hear. It can be hit or miss nowadays with COVID-19 around. I've seen on the KDE.org goals website that you've got some information there. Could you expand on those?
Yeah, sure. So KDE has elected three goals that we want to work on for the next few years. And we actually extended the current goals a bit because we actually want to have a in-person sprint at least once to work on together with these goals. So we have the KDE's All About the Apps goal, where it means we want to strengthen our ecosystem and bring KDE apps to more platforms like macOS, Windows, and Android. And then we also have the Wayland goal, which was a big topic at Academy. There were presentations about Wayland stability. For example, there was a demo about how applications can actually survive when the universe is coming crashing down when your Wayland compositor goes away. So that was very impressive. And then we also have the consistency goal, where we just want to focus on making sure that all of our applications and the desktop and everything works like very consistently and easy to use and unified.
There's a good choice of goals that should benefit the work going in and what's coming out. How's the migration to Qt 6 going?
So yeah, we actually have the KDE Framework 6 in the works, but you know, these Qt transitions, they are a once in a decade chance to clean up our APIs because we have a very long guarantee in terms of API and ABI stability. So we can't just remove things between major versions. So we're not just porting blindly to Qt 6, we're actually also trying to clean up our APIs and get rid of cruft that has accumulated over the years.
Well, I do like a clean API. Are there any new initiatives or projects in KDE?
Yeah, actually, we now have an initiative about sustainable computing with the Blue Angel, or the German Blauer Engel, which focuses on power consumption and reusability. Like, you don't throw away old computers. You might actually be able to use them longer with KDE software on it. And also, we want to focus more on actually measuring and being able to track over time the power consumption of our software.
Blue Angel is such a cool name. The power consumption is also a good focus, especially due to the recent focus of crypto miners and how much they're impacting the environment. And then, of course, for people using our lovely old technology, batteries. All right. Well, thank you very much for your time, Kai-Uwe.
All right. Thanks for having me.
Okay. So now I have Jesper Petersen on the line from the Qt Widgets and More YouTube series. Hi, Jesper.
Hello, Robert. How are you today?
I'm fine. Thank you. So this series has been going on for a while now with pretty good success. Do you know how many episodes you've released so far?
I believe we're up at 25 episodes. Been recording steadily for the last year or so now.
Yeah, that's pretty good going already, actually. And how did you come up with the idea for the series?
Well, you know, KDAB has lots and lots of good material out on YouTube already for cutting edge 3D or super advanced CMake or whatever. And I thought, hey, we want some material that caters to people that uses the good old Qt widget, because there are so much to know about that. And I've been around Qt widgets for 20 years and know my way around it. So I thought, I can totally pull it off. So I wanted this show, Advanced Qt Widget, but I didn't really dare to use the word advanced because people just attack me on saying, hey, that's not advanced. I knew that trick or that trick. So wanted something lighter on it. So Qt widgets and more. And then the and more part would soften up and allow me to talk about different things.
Yeah, it's pretty true about the advanced thing. And Qt widgets and more just rolls off the tongue. And The way you can shorten it to QAM is also pretty nice. Do you have a favorite episode?
Oh, come on, Robert. You can't ask me questions like this. A favorite episode. Who do you love more of your kids, right? If I really need to mention a favorite episode, I think that every single Qt developer who's using Model View ought to watch the episode of how you communicate between the view and the model, where probably there's a bunch of proxy models in between. That's a pretty good episode. And then I believe that a good developer is, the best developers are those that has their tooling completely under control. You know, the good old joke about the two guys that was out in the wood and cutting down trees, and one said to the other, how come that you are so much faster than me? You've been sitting down half of the time. And the other answers, well, I wasn't sitting down. I was actually sharpening my tools. And I think that's super important. So any episode on how to improve your tools, I think that are good episodes. And that actually reminds me, there's an episode that we haven't yet released even. Let me do a bit of promotion for that one. It's about how do you speed up your compilation process. So I was switching from Windows to Linux, and I was wondering, should I be using Clang or GCC? Should I be using Make or Ninja? Should I be using pre-compile headers? And how about Zcash? And two episodes came out of this where, in the end, my compilation time was cut down almost to half of the time that my original setup had. And that's pretty good.
Excellent. Thanks for all that information, Jesper.
Thank you for having me on your show.
Anytime. Thanks. Qt 6.2 is the first Qt 6 release, which includes all widely used Qt add-on modules previously available in the Qt 5.15 release. Compared to Qt 6, it brings support to 13 additional modules, totaling over 50 modules. On top of this, Qt 6.2 is also the first release in the Qt 6 series to provide long-term support for commercial licensees. The Qt 6.2 release extends the Qt 6 promise of limitless scalability with supporting Vulkan, Metal, and Direct 3D 12 as new deployment environments for hardware-accelerated graphics. Among the 13 add-on modules previously not available with Qt 6, it also brings significantly updated Qt Multimedia, as well as the widely used Qt Bluetooth and Qt Web Engine modules, improving your ability to innovate in next-generation user experiences. More about the alpha version can be found in the link below. A new feature update of Qt for MCUs is now available. It allows you to create your application on Linux systems and for new target platforms, get access to the new pointed item and font quality APIs, discover new demos and examples, and more. Qt Quick Ultralight maintains source compatibility between minor releases. However, some changes may require you to adapt the application code accordingly. The complete list of changes can be found below the video. Tool of the month, Range V3. Ranges are an extension of the standard template library that makes its iterators and algorithms more powerful by making them composable. Unlike other range-like solutions, which seek to do away with iterators, in Range V3, ranges are an abstraction layer on top of iterators. Range V3 is built on three pillars: views, actions, and algorithms. The algorithms are the same as those with which you are already familiar in the STL, except that in Range V3, all the algorithms have overloads that take ranges in addition to the overloads that take iterators. Views are composable adaptations of ranges, where the adaptation happens lazily as the view is iterated. And finally, an action is an eager application of an algorithm to a container that mutates the container in place and returns it for further processing. Range V3 allows you to write very expressive code, similar to how you would do it in Python. If you're interested and want more information, follow the link below. Qt DevCon. The call for papers is coming to an end soon, and the agenda will be published shortly after that. Also, the training day offerings are about to be announced, so watch out for any announcements and get your ticket. As there are still restrictions regarding the maximum number of participants, there will only be a limited number of tickets available for the time being. If restrictions do get lifted, there might be more tickets added later. If you don't get a ticket for the live event, or aren't able, or of course comfortable traveling to Berlin end of September, you can also get an online pass. You'll find all of the information and updates on qtdevcon.com or in our social media channels. Links below the video. You've probably already heard about the new C++ 20 standard and maybe even had a first look. Ivan Cukic and Giuseppe D'Angelo have prepared the Practical Programmer's Guide to C++ 20 for you. They talk in detail about the biggest four improvements: concepts, coroutines, modules, and ranges, but also share a couple of smaller changes that they think are interesting. So enjoy the journey to C++ 20. Don't panic. Keep your arms inside the vehicle at all times and always carry a towel. Thank you for watching. Stay safe and feel free to share any feedback or questions below the video. I'll see you next time.